Thanks for coming. I'm talking about the GHCi debugger, which is a piece of software you always have if you have a Haskell compiler installed, but a lot of Haskell programs and use it. First, a little introduction. And nowadays, every bad movie starts with commercials, so I also start with a list of commercials. The debugger is fully integrated into GHCi. If you have the repo, you also have the debugger. You don't need any additional program or tool, nothing new to install, no special files, nothing. You don't need to recompile your programs, and the debugger is always at your service. Every Haskell program that you can load into GHCi can be debugged. Here is a little star. There is a last line. Commercials never tell the full truth. And also there are no restrictions on language extensions or library. Also here you can find one or the other extension or library where it's not work, but it works for most of the extensions and libraries you normally use. You have the full power of the interactive Haskell evaluator at your fingertips when you are at your breakpoints. And it is a simple interactive model. It has breakpoints and traces. Traces are normally not in these debuggers, but this is due to historical reasons. Now, if we, do you see my cursor? Yes. If we reverse this arrow, then we get co-commercials. The debugger works only for bytecode, not for object code. You can today, you can now load bytecode programs and object code programs into GHCi. But the debugger works only for bytecode. And it has an awkward user interface. It's from the types for engineers, for engineers. It has no easy-to-use API for editors and IDEs, which is, I think, a very strong co-commercial. Sometimes laziness may be confusing, and if you are on a breakpoint and you see that the value should be 1 and it is 2, you cannot set it to 1. Just to, in normal object-oriented debuggers, you can always change your variables and then look with We have no stack traces. This means we don't see who was calling this function. And we cannot debug parallel programs, which are one of the 7 points of Haskell. We cannot debug some modern type level hackery stuff you all do. And we cannot debug GHCi or GHC in GHCi because there we need objects. Now, if you look at the programming language Haskell, it is a very rich language. It has all bells and whistles you can imagine. It has even more than I can imagine. If you look at the Haskell report, the section just about the language, without libraries and all other stuff, is about 150 pages. We have more than 130 language extensions. And the Haskell book from First Principles, today probably best tutorial book, is more than 1,200 pages. Now, the compiler takes this rich language and translates it to POR or SDG, which then is executed in what they call the virtual machine. This is a very tiny language. Minimalistic. If you describe it as a Haskell data type, it has only 10 constructors, which will fit on one slide. If we put these things together, on the left side we have the rich thing, and this is programmer's world. You are thinking, dreaming, I hope, in this rich language. On the other side, core SDGs, execution language, this is GHCi's world. And now the task of the debugger is to hide this gap. And this gap is much broader than in object-oriented languages, where there is a this is not difficult to compare. The debugger was written 2007 by Simon Marlowe and some co-authors, and they published, as always in Haskell, when you wrote something fancy, they published a paper. It's a good paper. If you have time to read it, then read it. Now, there are also common features in Haskell and in SDG, core SDG. On both sides, we have function applications, we have case expressions, and in Haskell, we call things function parameters. The same things are called free variables in the lambda expressions and in core. But it's more or less the same. So the debugger is built on these two, on these common things. The debugger, now we are coming to the debugger, has two different modes, breakpoints and tracing. We will start with the breakpoints. As a break, you stop the execution of the program. You have it only in the created mode, I have already told this. And then breakpoints are not possible in installed libraries because they are object code. If you want to debug a library, you have to download the source code and load the source code into GHCi. Now a breakpoint corresponds to a function application. And it is not really a point, it is a span. And during compilation, GHC calculates all possible breakpoints and makes a list which it then uses. I will use for most of my demo this little sort program, which is an insertion sort. It should work. I didn't add hidden box. I can show the feature of the debugger at this little program. Now, these are the pre-calculated breakpoints or break spans of this little program. Now we can go, we can take the last line, or the first, we take the first. This is, these are the numbers of the breakpoints. This is the module we are in, this is the line, and these are the columns. Now if we go back, now what did we have? From line 8, column 15 to 17. This is here, line 8, column 15 to 17. You have to believe me. But I added all these things here. Always these indications are the breakpoints. Here, and here, this is a long one, line 5. On line 7 there is nothing, we don't have breakpoints on type, function type specifications. Here we have one, here we have one, and now here we have two, because there are two functions. So insert functions and the const function of the list. Now I will demo it first time. Oh, yeah, a bit too far. I actually put the switch. Okay. That's it, you can read this. If it is too big, I can make it a little bit. Oh. So, we have now here in the printed mode because it's a normal source code. We can say we want break at line 5 of our program. And it says yes, and it also says which source span it is. So in your editor, you can look up whether this is what you really wanted. Now we can do a little sort. And if this is too scary for you, you can say abandon. And then you are out again. If you don't like it, but we have to go in again. You can also say just can pass all commands, you can abbreviate. So we go in again, and then we say again, sort car. And it is a little bit cumbersome always to look up this in the listing. Therefore, there is a command called list, and the list command shows where you are in your program. This is rather handy. And the function which we really are debugging is highlighted if your terminal supports highlighting. Now there is the next command is called, the simple command is continue. I normally write only cont and it goes to the next print, which for us is the same, but you see here we add the first letter C and here we are now on the second letter. So it moved a little bit. And if I do again a count, we are on the last, and then we are out again. So I have just here summarized the most important commands, I call them. We have break, set the breakpoint, abandon, exit the current debugger, list, shows the source code, continue, run to the next breakpoint. Now, next, yeah, we go again in. We say, so, when you are at the breakpoint, it tells you where you are, as you have seen. It prepares and binds a variable to the result. This is the result of this function, where you are, where you have set your breakpoint. And it shows all the three variables. The first one, the x, is already evaluated, and the next one is xs is not evaluated. It is still sunk because Haskell is working lazy. Yes, next. This is again the summary. What happens? There is one word for these three variables. It may happen that one is missing sometimes. In rare cases, the one or the other may be missing. This is when the debugger has a problem in looking these things up, it throws it away. Now, we want normally to look at the values, and we have two possibilities. We can look at the values without evaluation and with evaluation.
Just out of curiosity, how do you learn about that there are variables which are thrown away?
From the program, from the source code of Haskell. And there was a bug where it mangled them up.
And when you were trying it out? Or
It was a Haskell, it was a ticket for the developers, and I looked at it, and then I have seen that in C situation it will just remove the value, and then it was it didn't match anymore.
Okay.
He had two arrays or two lists, one with names of the three variables and one with the values, and there one was missing, and the first of course was missing. And so the types didn't match. And then the solution was to throw out the corresponding free value.
Yeah.
Okay, where are we? Yeah, I see. And we start again. Okay, this one is evaluated. XS is not evaluated. We have two commands. We have print. Print XS. What it does, it binds it to a new variable named T1 and says it is a list of characters. In this case, it does not help. But sometimes if you have records, it will give you, for every record field, it will give you a known variable name. And the underscore P means that it is a sum. It's not yet evaluated. The other one is sprint. Sprint is what is used by default. So it doesn't show us anything more than we already see. But if you want to know the values here, you have to evaluate them. There is no way around it. And we can also, as I did forgot it, I can now again say print this underscore T1. And it starts again. But it's all the same in the end. So we do not gain any more information. We have to evaluate. And evaluate, you can do several things. You can force them. There's a command force, XS, and it will evaluate. You can also force the result, which is the result of the function. And then, to calculate this, it has to stop at breakpoints, but because you said force, it will ignore these breakpoints and jump over them. We have basically for every letter of our source thing, we have a breakpoint that we You can also use sec, or you can, if you do it again.
So the result corresponds to the expression which is basically described by the span?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, yes. Also the parameters correspond to the span.
Mm-hmm.
And it always tells you, when you define the breakpoint, it always tells you the span. So you know where you are. Now I think we continue here. Also here I summarize this. We have two commands, print and simple print. And if you want to evaluate, to see values you have to evaluate. This may be tricky. If you are using exceptions and catching exceptions, then you are changing the logic of your program. Also, if you have infinite lists, when you evaluate something that is an infinite list, then you are in deep problems because it will never stop. You can use force, or you can use sec from the library function, or you can just evaluate it normally. Now, next thing is, it's a little bit, if you say sort something, and now you want to know where we are, and it is not the place you want it to be, you say count, and again it doesn't tell you where you are, so you can automate this. You can say set, stop, list, and then it does this. This means at every stop it will execute the command list. You can do this also if you say set, stop your command, this is valid for all your breakpoints. But you can say I want it only for my breakpoint number 2. Then you say set, stop, 2 and your command. You will see you can define your own commands. Then it makes more sense to have these two different things. As normally you set stop list, and I recommend to put set stop list in your defaults file if you are using the debugger. Next thing is the syntax for the break commands. You can give an identifier, a line and a column, a module and a module, a line and a column. Here, I will need a second program, which are only 3 lines, import my sort, then a main program which calls the sort function. Now I can say break sort, the identifier. Function has two cases of the list, the empty list and the normal list is x cons x has. And if you give just the name of the function, it does not know which you want, so it breaks it both. Yeah, then a function insert, we try to break an insert and it doesn't know this function. I only exported the sort function, I didn't export the insert function, and you can only break by name if the name is in scope. And insert is not in scope. But you can say break module dot insert. No, it doesn't work. Huh? You can't say this. It's if it's non-existing, it's non-existing. If you don't have the name in scope, you can't go by name. The next one is break 3. This break, the line 3 was the one with this line name is a type I know. You cannot break on line 3. You can break on line 4. This gives a new breakpoint, and you can break on line 4. 19 was one. You can say break on line 4, column 19. If you don't know it exactly, then it will go to the one nearest to the left, and this is 19, and this we already defined, so it tells you it's already defined. But you can go into the sort A. We can go into the module sort, and there we can again break at every line we want. Now, the next demo is what happens. So here are again these things. And the summary, only identifiers and scope can be used. If we miss the exact breakpoints number, it takes the one next to the left. And you cannot set breakpoints and time specifications of functions. Sometimes you are in a situation where the breakpoints don't work. We take again our main program. We break therefore of the subprogram. And we execute, you remember the main had a this is line 4 with the empty thing, and this is line 5. And the main one has here a predefined, we can run it. So I think sort on line 4, we have this already defined. Now I run the main and I see that I'm on the wrong line. I continue and I say sort 5 and I say main. It doesn't stop anymore. This is a bug. There is a, and it's not really, it's a half, it's half a bug. First, it's not a bug. Because what we have here, this sort thing, is a so-called CAF, a constant application form, and GHCi evaluates CAFs only once, and then it retains the result. It's very handy if you have something complicated, you do it in a main function, and then you run it, and then the first time it breaks, and later it doesn't break. You can do a set R, and then GHCi should not retain the result of a cough, but the bug is that this set R is not working. And it's rather annoying because you are so used to have these things in the main function. It's handy, you can just say main or another function where everything is constant, and then you are suddenly you forget it. The next problem is the polymorphism. Now we are here. Yeah, and we say sort A's, and then we look at XS, we want to look at XS, and it has no show arising. It doesn't know what type A is. Here we have A, it is not able to calculate this type. The reason is during compilation, GHC erases all type information. And then the debugger does something called RTTI, which stands for real time interference. It tries to recalculate this type. And here it only sees that it is something that has a show instance. And it cannot, if you want to do this, you have to tell it that this is, now you can't do this way. This will not work. Well, this will not work. You have to say, you have to say, this is a reported error. This is, it's not easy to fix, but it is reported. You have to say, sorry. Here, A's, and here you say int. Now you see, it knows it's int. And it is able to show the values. So if you have polymorphic code, this may happen to you. Now the next thing is nested breakpoints. We are on a breakpoint, and we do again a sort ABC. Then we get here these three lines, these three dots. And now we are on the second call of the sort function. This happens, for instance, when you evaluate values. And as this is a small recursive function, you don't really know where you are. And for this, we have a command, where is it? Show context. It tells us we have two concurrent evaluations pending of this sort of function. You can again with this up and down command, you can kick out the first one. We have only one now, and with the second outcome, everything is gone if it gets too confusing.
I have a question regarding the types. What exactly is Haskell bytecode? Like, at what stage is bytecode generated, or like, does it still contain type information?
No,
or?
No, it doesn't contain type information.
Okay.
It is, so it has to, and it uses a lot of the functions used for the normal type inference. Simon Marlowe, in one of his papers, writes that it would be easier because you know that there are no type errors, because everything went already through the type checker, and then you know it's type already type checked properly, but there is no much literature about it, which is a real-time type interference. Next thing is managing our breakpoints. I need some. You can say show breaks, then you get a list of your active breakpoints. you can delete them by number. One, or you can delete multiple. If you delete multiple, there is no comma needed. I see the comma, it doesn't like the comma. Oh, it liked it, but it's not needed. But you can also delete with a star, and this removes all of your records. Now, sometimes you don't want to, where are we? We are somewhere here. This was a polymorphism. Executes the program and it stops in this module sort, but here it still says, do you see my cursor? Yes. Here it still says we are in module main, but we are in module, since the break is in module sort, not in the main. If we try to get the type of our insert function, it says, I don't know, it is not in scope. It knows the one of our sort function because this we exported. And to be able to look at it, we have to use the module command, which loads the module, and it needs a star. Sort. And now we are on sort, and we can now look at the type of our insert function, or at other functions. But it does not switch automatically to the module where the breakpoint is. We have to do it manually. Yes, it doesn't change the scope. You have to use this star. Don't forget the star. If you forget the star, it will not show hidden functions. Nested breakpoints we have seen. C3 dots are the summary, the indications for nested. Breakpoints show context. Can use the list, the stacked breakpoints, and abandon you. Managing breakpoint we have seen. Now, disabling breakpoints. There is no disable command. You have to do a trick. You have to set the action to continue. Instead of saying set stop list, you say set stop continue. And you can also say set stop only the number continue, the number of your breakpoint. And these two versions, they work differently. can do the first one. Now we sort again something, and it really does it, it is the same. If you do the other one, it will stop at everyone, at every breakpoint, and it will print the little summary, and then it will continue. So they are, I don't know why this is, but it is like this. Standard enable and disable commands, where you can enable. Normally, if you set them, they are enabled, but then you can disable them with a column disable and either star for all or a list of numbers, and you can enable them again. This allows you, because with this method, it's a constrict, you use other things, other commands you have on your breakpoints. You can only have one command. And with this disable command, you will not use this other continuing setting, as this is other breakpoint setting. But you have to wait after Christmas. Now you can define your own command. You do it with def, you can also undefine them. You do it with def and undef. You can say define a name and an expression, and undef a name. Define if you're using for the first time, when you over define it the first time. When it's not okay, when you see it's not okay, and you have to redefine it, then you need the explanation. Then you give a name, it cannot start with a column or an exclamation mark, and you give an expression. This is then either a function, a predefined function, or a lambda expression of type string to any string. I can do it once. I say I first define the function. That's easier. Let my tie. This is one which does not take a parameter, so I will not use the parameter. And we say good. This has only type IO, we need type IO string, so we have to add something. return. Define our what? It's called type. We overwrite type, and we say it's my type. It's a function my type. Now, if we want to know the type of sort, then it says it has gone. If we redefine it. Then it says it's already defined. That's why we have to use the second type. We have to use the exclamation mark. And then it can redefine it. But the old type command is still available with two columns. Type sort. Now, break, we have some record, show breaks, we have still a breakpoint. If we do a load of a module, even if it is the same, the breaks are removed, deleted. However, our redefined type sort is still here. You have really to undefine if you don't want it anymore. Now you can use this to do fancy things. You can say so. You can say if my CMD, and then we do a lambda. Lines, and then first element, and then we have X, and then we have XS, and we have comp. Now we say again break 5, the famous break 5, and we say set stop 0 my command, and we say so now we have defined this command. We can now say it sort always at every breakpoint it does these three dashes, so we know we are at the new breakpoint. It prints the value of xx and it prints the value of xs. So we see rather quickly what is going on. And so you can automate your debugging sessions. But the risk is that you need more brain power to program your debugger than to find your bug. Next thing is, this is the example, and the commands survive with the reload commands, breakpoints will be deleted, multiple commands we have seen, this is what I typed, and then we have this command. You say command and expression. And the expression is a Haskell expression of type IO string. And then this expression is evaluated, which gives a new string. And this new string must contain another Haskell expression. And this will be evaluated. So it sounds rather complicated, is complicated. And this can be used to build conditional breakpoints. Now I have to copy the string. I will not type this manually. I have to copy it in different three steps. Here I define a command called cond, and this is the expression. And in this expression we have this command, and the function has a parameter x so on, and then we put this x into a if, and we take the same. When this is true, then we return nothing, which means it breaks. And the other way, if it is not true, then we return continue, which means it continues. It goes to the next breakpoint. Now here. So. Now I can do say set stop 0 condition x equal a. Now we can sort that, something like this, and we
there a colon
maybe
missing?
A colon before the cont?
I need a colon, yes, before the cont. No, I don't think.
Don't you have it on slides to copy?
Pardon?
I think if you had it on slides, so you could copy.
Yeah, I have it on the slide.
Right with the colon but without the parentheses.
Is it stop? Ah, yes, I have to do it this way. Now it doesn't show anything, but we know we have this x variable, and there we have the a, and in the xs variable we have the last three letters, so it skipped the first three breaks at the first three letters or characters. But it is not to use, more or less. Because what do you want? You don't want to program this. You want to debug a bug. You want to find a bug. And you have to use a lot of brake power to do these things. Next one. Well, I think it is awful. And it is string manipulation. It is not Haskell. Haskell is with types. Mm. And there are better solutions, but a little bit more elaborate. It will take another talk about strongly typed GHCi commands. It is a good block post, recommended one. Now, next thing is ignore a breakpoint for a specified number of iterations. In GDB we have an ignore, then the breakpoint, and then the count. I leave this as an exercise, and I have to say that I invested 2 hours and it didn't work within the 2 hours. It is not easy. The main problem is you have to store somewhere the value of your counter, and this is state. And as we all know, Haskell and state is a little bit more difficult than standard Haskell. I will pay a beer for those of you who can do it. Next is stepping. We again do this. I normally start from fresh, then we know what we have. This you can just start step, and then the expression you want to. We set stop list, and then we say step, so No, the columns are missing. There's a common error. Now it steps, it stops at the first breakpoint, and then you can do a count. How does it work here? And it, oh, it doesn't show where we are, huh? Let's do it again, huh? Something longer. Oh, we have to say step. No, we have to say comment. Do we still have?
I think comp just continues and we don't have any breakpoints, so it doesn't stop anymore, so it just finishes. If you just type step without arguments, does it then step further?
Probably. No, it is step. Yes, it is step. So we don't have any breakpoints. We say set stop list, and then we say step. And we say step and it steps through. Not very, just because it's a recursive program. It's not very, very instructive. You have to do it on your own code. Then it's more instructive. We have similar, we have step local, and it will only stop in the top level function. And we have step module, it will only stop in the current module. But they are not really, I don't see when you use them. This. And then we have here a summary. I don't do a demo of all. We have stop at the next breakpoint. Step module is stop at the next breakpoint in the current module. And step local is step only in a public function. It's I don't think it is worth to demo them. Next thing is tracing and history. Tracing you normally do normally not have in these debuggers. It just does a list of all evaluations it processes. And then you can look at this list. Yes, we do a demo. We do Q. And then we take in our famous subprogram. We do a break at 4 this time. And we say, then it stops somewhere, and then you can look at the history. we scan the recursive program, which stops at two different breakpoints, 51, 25, and 15. And we see what is happening. Then we can go back as the newest is this one, and the first was the -16 one. Now we can go backwards. And then we are in -1. We can go backward 3, we are -4. And what the trick is, the values are also preserved. So we can look at the x here, it was h. We go 1 more back, 2 more back, and we can look at the value of the x, it was a. So if you know in your place where you are, you can see what is happening, but normally it's too confusing. But there was a program called HAT, Haskell Trace, and this was before they developed this debugger, and this was heavily in use. So everybody wanted it because they were used to it, they wanted to keep it. But I think it is not really something which is useful. But there is another thing which is sometimes very useful. And this is so-called break on error. For this, I will have a big program. There's a library HaskellerZ. We can run, we can put it into our GHCi evaluator. Yes. And it loads all these programs. And then we can run it on a program source. We have to set some parameters. Yes, and the problem is now here. It says head empty list, and it's rather a large library. We have seen 17 volumes, and the question is now, where is this head of empty list? And I go out again and in again. Now I set the, when I run it first time I could set the arguments just after the main. But here I can't do this, I have to set the arguments to GHCi, and this is done with underscore CSS. This is normal GHCs, and then we source.hs. This corresponds to what I did before. And then I do a set f break on error. And I say trace main. And now it stops on this error, I can go back one step and I can ask, where are we? And then we are exactly ahead of an empty list, which fails this exception. But for this is rather useful. We have also a break on exception, which breaks on IO exceptions or on loops. If you have a loop, you do it with break on exception, and then you press Ctrl-C when you are in the loop, and you go back a little bit and you see where you are in the loop. And this yes, we have these commands, breaks, history, forward, back. And if the history is 50 entries, if that's not enough for you, you can set it to any number you have memory for. Here are the pros and cons of this history stuff. It gives quickly an overview, it's faster than stepping, the values are preserved, the list command is working. The cons is you can set the history command only when you are stopped at the breakpoint. So you have to find the latest place where you can set a breakpoint. That's not always easy in your functions. And the evaluations, the values are preserved, but the evaluation state, how much is evaluated, is not preserved. It's always, when you evaluate a value later on, then you will see in your earlier stepping history, you will see the later value, the longer value, which is more evaluated. Then we have the demo break on error, break on exception, and then three slides on the implementation. Also we have again this table, which is generated during the debugger, at the end, after type checking, before it throws away all the source pointers to the source when it's as an after type checking. And then we have this core language. As SDG is very similar, I have taken this core, which I at the beginning said it fits on one slide. Here is this slide. And there we have a tick constructor with a tickish type. Also we have this variable iterators, then the apply of an argument to an expression, the lambda expressions, the let stuff, the case and the cast. These things. And this tick now is used for all these things with profiling, Haskell program coverage, and also breakpoints. We store there the breakpoint ID, this number, and a list of the three variables. And then, after the debugger, these are in, and we see these breaks here, and here, and here. And we see also the three variables. Then in bytecode, there is a bytecode break function, and there we see the number, the module. And then, when it runs on such a break, function bytecode. It has to check for everyone the table, the mod break table in the module, and then it has to look whether the breakpoint, not block, breakpoint is active or whether it is in a trace. And if it is active or in a trace, it has to stop and return back to the front end to take the appropriate action. And that's the end of my presentation.
Any questions?
Do you know whether there's any work going on integrating this debugging experience into an editor? So, I mean, it's quite typing heavy.
It's typing heavy, yes. I don't know. There is one package for Visual Studio Code.
For the editor?
For the editor, yes. But I have never...
For the debugger. Okay.
But the main problem, from my point of view, is that we don't have an API for GHCi. There is a ticket, please do it. It's marked for beginners. No beginner took it till now. It gives a lot of work. And when you have this, then you can, on top of this, you can build an API for the debugger. There is, other this, the interpreter is running in a known process. And you can move this own process to another machine. So there is a communication between the front end and the interpreter, which tells the interpreter to set breakpoints, and the interpreter reports, I am at a breakpoint, and sees there is a protocol. You can use this in an editor, but then you have to program all the front end part of the commands, you have to program yourself. These are, the, from my point of view, the two ways to do it. Either you do real good API for GHCi and you build in the debugger, or you do it just for the debugger, and then you set up on this
chance to compare in your project, sort of using this debugger to just printf debugging, so throwing debug.trace statements into your code?
Although printf debugging is what I normally use because I am working in GHCi and there I cannot use this debugger.
But even if you could use it, would you use it? It seems to me like, I mean, just the coding you did to sort of print the state of the program, you get that quite similarly if you're just doing a debug trace show this pair before this evaluation.
I cannot answer whether I would use it or not. As in the projects I did before, small little personal project, I used it from time to time.
Okay.
And I also use it when I look at code of other people's I don't understand. Because but it is not so easy as in this object-oriented debugging, where you went out in the evening, you drank one or two beers too much, and then in the morning you step through your program because you are not really motivated to work. And then you learn how, you see how this is working, where it goes through. You understand a little bit this program.
So are you saying the bad user experience of the GCI debugger actually keeps you from procrastinating?
But here, the main problem is the lazy evaluation. If you do it with a more complicated program, you will see it jumps around because it needs from here a result of the function, and this function is not yet evaluated. So it goes to one more back. So it is very, if you do, as I recommend to do it on your projects, well, then you get a feeling for it, whether you can use it or not. But the fact that most of the Haskellers don't use it says that it is probably not available.
Sorry if you mentioned this and I didn't hear it. Can you induce evaluation from the debugger? Can you tell it to evaluate the time?
Yes,
like when
yes.
You can. Yeah?
Yes,
right.
You can.
So, okay.
Yes, the evaluation you can, unless you have infinite lists.
Sure, but you can definitely demand, okay?
Yes.
Just go chase this now.
You can demand, yes. And you can also do this step into and step over. A step into you will do that you evaluate all your
I'm asking
variables.
This because you ought to be able to write a mode that never jumps into things that were demanded, but only in the current code. You know, you have the code that you're executing, and it could conceivably not ignore the breakpoints that are in code from different stacks, right?
No.
Conceivably. I mean, because there is a revision when a last thread was a huge problem.
What you can do is you can manually evaluate all your free variables, and then you can do a step, and because you have everything is now evaluated, it will really step into the next function.
Right, but what I'm saying is that intuitively it should be possible to have a mode that just does that.
Yes, you could have a mode.
And it will be really nice, I presume, at least.
Yes.
But you are making it evaluate quite differently from how it would evaluate.
Yes, you would have a mode which at the breakpoint you evaluate all three variables.
Oh, I don't mean that you evaluate them eagerly, but like you don't stop from code that gets pulled in through tanks.
Yeah, but how do you know when to stop and not to stop?
You should be able to mark the stack, right? Anyway, I don't know. I
there was an approach before they had this debugger, which was called optimistic evaluation. And it was an author, I don't remember its name, together with Simon Payton-Jones.
Mm-hmm.
But they wrote a paper, but they never implemented it, because it would have meant a second evaluation mechanism within the compiler.
Somebody did evaluate until you hit an error?
Yes.
Right.
Optimistic evaluation
sure.
Of error. So you can search for Simon Payton-Jones and optimistic evaluation, and you will get on a table where they describe what one could do. But they never did.
How does it work for take 10, 1, dot, dot? I think it's interesting, I don't know what this is.
For all the functions you did to get some custom functionality, like stop at the third iteration and so on,
yes.
From what I understood, you could write these into your .ghci somewhere, right? So you have to do that only once, and then you just can load it. So do you know of any collections of, maybe some people did already, some collections of functions?
I searched for it.
Okay, so nothing good out in the internet?
Maybe I didn't search good enough, but
okay.
I didn't find anything. I searched on Stack Overflow and all these things, but
the interface was a bit simpler, it would maybe be more useful, right?
Also, the user guide has a section on the debugger.
Mm-hmm.
And they also say, you can do it similar with loops.
Mm-hmm.
And what I tried was with an IOREF, but I was not on the same level. You have to set the number, the original number you want to stop after 20 executions.
Mm-hmm.
So you have to stop to set this 20 somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
And then you have to take, read it, decrement, and write it again.
Mm-hmm.
My problem was that also the name of this IOREF was the same. The scope was not the same because I did it. When you do a normal line for evaluation, it more or less does a module for this line and stores it as a module. Then I couldn't access it. Please try and publish. Write a blog post about it. Okay, so thanks for listening.
Thanks again for the talk.
Yeah.